The Reign of the Dragon, The Wars of King Aegon I. The long reign of King Aegon I Targaryen, 1 AC to 37 AC, was by and large a peaceful one, in his later years especially. But before the dragon's peace, as the last two decades of his kingship were later called by the Maesters of the Citadel, came the Dragon's Wars, the last of which was as cruel and bloody a conflict as any fought in Westeros. Though the Wars of the Conquest were said to have ended when Aegon was crowned and anointed by the High Septon and the Starry Sept of Old Town, not all of Westeros had yet submitted to his rule. In the Bight, the Lords of the Three Sisters had taken advantage of the chaos of Aegon's conquest to declare themselves a free nation and crown Lady Marla of House Sunderland their queen. As the Aaron fleet had been largely destroyed during the conquest, the king commanded his Warden of the North, Torrhen Stark of Winterfell, to end the Sistermen's rebellion, and a northern army departed from White Harbor on a fleet of hired Bravosi galleys under the command of Sir Warwick Manderley. The sight of his sails and the sudden appearance of Queen Visenya and Vhagar in the skies above Sisterton took the heart out of the Sistermen. They promptly deposed Queen Marla in favor of her younger brother. Stefan Sunderland renewed his fealty to the Eyrie, bent the knee to Queen Visenya, and gave his sons over as hostages for his good behavior, one to be fostered with the Manderleys, the other with the Arryns. His sister, the deposed queen, was exiled and imprisoned. After 5 years, her tongue was removed, and she spent the remainder of her life with the Silent Sisters, tending to the noble dead. On the other side of Westeros, the Iron Islands were in chaos. House Hor had ruled the Iron Men for long centuries, only to be extinguished in a single night when Aegon unleashed Beleriand's fires on Harrenhal. Though Harren the Black and his sons perished in those flames, Corrin Volmark of Harlaw, whose grandmother had been a younger sister of Harren's grandsire, declared himself the rightful heir of the Black Line and assumed the kingship. Not all Ironborn accepted his claim, however. On Old Wick, under the bones of Naga the Sea Dragon, the priests of the Drowned God placed a driftwood crown on the head of one of their own, the barefoot holy man Lodos, who proclaimed himself the living son of the Drowned God and was said to be able to work miracles. Other claimants arose on Great Wick, Pike, and Orcmont, and for more than a year, their adherents battled one another on land and sea. It was said that the waters between the islands were so choked with corpses that krakens appeared by the hundreds, drawn by the blood. Aegon Targaryen put an end to the fighting. He descended on the islands in 2 AC, riding Beleriand. With him came the war fleets of the Arbor, Highgarden, and Lannisport, and even a few longships from Bear Island dispatched by Torrhen Stark. The Iron Men, their numbers diminished by a year of fratricidal war, put up little resistance. Indeed, many hailed the coming of the dragons. King Aegon slew Corrin Volmark with Blackfyre, but allowed his infant son to inherit his father's lands and castle. On Old Wick, the priest king Lodos, purported son of the Drowned God, called upon the krakens of the deep to rise and drag down the invaders' ships. When that failed to happen, Lodos filled his robes with stones and walked into the sea.
"To seek my father's counsel!"
Thousands followed, their bloated, crab-eaten bodies washed up on the shores of Old Wick for years to come. Afterward, the issue arose as to who should rule the Iron Islands for the king. It was suggested that the Iron Men be made vassals of the Tullys of Riverrun or the Lannisters of Casterly Rock. Some even urged that they be given over to Winterfell. Aegon listened to each claim, but in the end decided that he would allow the Ironborn to choose their own Lord Paramount. To no one's surprise, they chose one of their own. Viconn Greyjoy, Lord Reaper of the Pike. Lord Viconn did homage to King Aegon, and the dragon departed with his fleets. Greyjoy's writ extended only to the Iron Islands, however. He renounced all claim to the lands House Hor had seized upon the mainland. Aegon granted the ruined castle of Harrenhal and its domains to Sir Quentin Cahoris, his master-at-arms at Dragonstone, but required him to accept Lord Edmund Tully of Riverrun as his liege lord. The new-made Lord Quentin had two strong sons and a plump grandson to assure the succession, but as his first wife had been carried off by spotted fever 3 years earlier, he further agreed to take one of the Lord Tully's daughters as his bride. With the submission of the Three Sisters and the Iron Islands, all of Westeros south of the Wall was now ruled by Aegon Targaryen, save Dorne alone. so it was to Dorne that the dragon next turned his attention. Aegon first attempted to win the Dornishmen with words, dispatching a delegation of High Lords, Maesters, and Septons to Sunspear to treat with Princess Meria Martell, the so-called Yellow Toad of Dorne, and persuade her of the advantage of joining her realm to his. Their negotiations continue for the best part of a year, but achieve nothing. The start of the First Dornish War is generally fixed at 4 AC, when Rhaenys Targaryen returned to Dorne. This time, she came with fire and blood, just as she had threatened. Riding Meraxes, the queen descended out of a clear blue sky and set the planky town ablaze, the fires leaping from boat to boat until the whole mouth of the Greenblood was choked with burning flotsam, and the pillar of smoke could be seen as far away as Sunspear. The denizens of the floating town took to the river for refuge from the flames. So fewer than 100 died in the attack, and most of those drowning rather than dragonfire. But first, blood had been shed. Elsewhere, Oris Baratheon led 1,000 picked knights up to the Boneway, whilst Aegon himself marched through the Prince's Pass at the head of an army 30,000 strong, led by near 2,000 mounted knights and 300 lords and bannermen. Lord Harlan Tyrell, the Warden of the South, was heard to say that they had more than enough power to smash any Dornish army that tried to stand before them, even without Aegon and Beleriand. No doubt he had right of that, but the issue was never proved, for Dornishmen never offered battle. Instead, they withdrew before King Aegon's host, burning their crops in the field and poisoning every well. The invaders found the Dornish watchtowers and the Red Mountains slighted and abandoned. In the high passes, Aegon's vanguard found its way barred by a wall of sheep carcasses, shorn of all wool and too rotted to eat. The king's army was already running short of food and fodder by the time they emerged from Prince's Pass to face the Dornish sands. There, Aegon divided his forces, sending Lord Tyrell south against Uther Uller, Lord of the Hellholt, whilst he himself turned eastward to besiege Lord Fowler in his mountain fastness Skyreach. It was the second year of autumn, and winter was thought to be too close at hand. In that season, the invaders hoped the heat in the desert would be less, water more plentiful. But the Dornish sun proved unrelenting as Lord Tyrell marched toward Hellholt. In such heat, men drink more, and every waterhole and oasis in the army's path had been poisoned. Horses began to die, more every day, followed by their riders. The proud knights discarded their banners, their shields, and their very armor. Lord Tyrell lost a quarter of his men and almost all his horses to the Dornish sands, and when at last reached the Hell Holt, he found it abandoned. Oris Baratheon's attack fared little better. His horses struggled on the stony slopes of the narrow, twisting passes, but many balked completely when they reached the steepest sections of the road, where the Dornish had chiseled steps into the mountains. Boulders rained down on the hands, knights from above. The work of the defenders, the Stormlanders never saw. Where the Boneway crossed the River Will, Dornish archers suddenly appeared as the column was making its way across a bridge, and arrows rained down by the thousands. When Lord Oris ordered his men to fall back, a massive rockfall cut off their retreat. With no way forward and no way back, the Stormlanders were butchered like hogs in a pen. Oris Baratheon himself was spared, along with a dozen other lords thought worth the ransom, but they found themselves captive of Will of Will, the savage mountain lord called Widow Lover. King Aegon himself had more success. Marching eastward through the foothills, where runoff from the heights provided water and game aplentiful in the valleys, he took the castle Skyreach by storm, won Ironwood after a brief siege. The Lord of the Tor had recently died, and his steward surrendered without a fight. Farther east, Lord Tolland of Ghost Hill sent forth his champion to challenge the king to single combat. Aegon accepted and slew the man, only to discover afterward that he had not been Tolland's champion, but his fool. Lord Tolland himself was gone, as was Meria Martell, the Princess of Dorne, when King Aegon descended upon Sunspear on Beleriand to find his sister Rhaenys there before him. After burning the planky town, she had taken lemonwood, spotswood, and stinkwater, accepting obeisances from old women and children, but nowhere finding an actual enemy. Even the shadow city outside the walls of Sunspear was half deserted, and none of those who remained would admit to any knowledge of the whereabouts of the Dornish lords and princess. The yellow toad has melted into the sands, Queen Rhaenys told King Aegon. Aegon's answer was a declaration of victory. In the Great Hall at Sunspear, he gathered together what dignitaries remained and told them that Dorne was now part of the realm, that henceforth they would be his leal subjects, that their former lords were rebels and outlaws. Rewards were offered for their heads, particularly that of the Yellow Toad, Princess Meriah Martell. Lord John Rosby was named Castellan of Sunspear and Warden of the Sands, to rule Dorne in the king's name. Stewards and Castellans were named for all the other lands and castles the conqueror had taken. Then King Aegon and his host departed, back the way they had come, west along the foothills through the Prince's Pass. They had hardly reached King's Landing before Dorne erupted behind them. Dornish spearmen appeared from nowhere like desert flowers after rain. Skyreach, Ironwood, the Tor, and Ghost Hill were all recaptured within a fortnight, their royal garrisons put to the sword. Aegon's Castellans and stewards were allowed to die only after a long torment. It was said that the Dornish lords had a wager over who could keep the captive the longest while still dismembering them. Lord Rosby, Castellan of Sunspear and Warden of the Sands, had a kinder end than most. After the Dornishmen swarmed in from the Shadow City to retake the castle, he was bound hand and foot, dragged to the top of the Spear Tower, and thrown from a window by none other than the aged Princess Meriah herself. Soon, only Lord Tyrell and his host remained. King Aegon had left Tyrell behind when he departed. Hellholt, a strong castle on the River Brimstone, was thought to be well situated to deal with any revolts. But the river was sulfurous, and the fish had taken from it made the High Gardener sick. House Corgyle of Sandstone had never submitted, and Corgyle spearmen cut down Tyrell's foraging parties and patrols whenever they strayed too far west. The Vaiths of Vaith did the same to the east. When word of the defenestration of Sunspear reached the Hellholt, Lord Tyrell gathered his remaining strength and set off across the sands. His announced intention was to capture Vaith, march east along the river, retake Sunspear and the Shadow City, and punish Lord Rosby's murderers. But somewhere east of the Hellholt, amidst the red sands, Tyrell and his entire army disappeared. No man of them was ever seen again. Aegon Targaryen was not a man to accept defeat. The war would drag on for another 7 years, though after 6 AC, the fighting degenerated into an endless bloody series of atrocities, raids, and retaliations, broken up by long periods of inactivity, a dozen short truces, and numerous murders and assassinations. In 7 AC, Orys Baratheon and the other lords who had been taken captive on the Boneway were ransomed back to King's Landing for their weight in gold, but on their return, it was found that the Widow Lover had lopped off each man's sword hand, so they might never again take up swords against Dorne. In retaliation, King Aegon himself descended on the mountain fastnesses of the Wills with Beleriand, and reduced half a dozen of their keeps and watchtowers to heaps of molten stone. The Wills took refuge in caves and tunnels beneath their mountains, however, and the Widow Lover lived another 20 years. In 8 AC, a very dry year, Dornish raiders crossed the Sea of Dorne on ships provided by a pirate king from the Stepstones, attacking half a dozen towns and villages along the south shore of Cape Wrath and setting fires that spread through half the Rainwood. "Fire for fire," Princess Meriah is reported to have said. This was not something the Targaryens would allow to go unanswered. Later that same year, Visenya Targaryen appeared in the skies of Dorne, and Vhagar's fires were loosed upon Sunspear, Lemonwood, Ghost Hill, and the Tor. In 9 AC, Visenya returned again, this time with Aegon himself flying beside her, and Sandstone, Vaith, and the Hellholt burned. The Dornish answer came the next year, when Lord Fowler led an army through the Prince's Pass and into the Reach, moving so swiftly that he was able to burn a dozen villages and capture the great border castle Night Song before the Marcher lords realized the foe was upon them. When the word of the attack reached Old Town, Lord Hightower sent his son Adam with a strong force to retake Night Song, but the Dornish had anticipated just that thing. A second Dornish army, under Sir Joffrey Dane, came down from Starfall and attacked the city. Old Town's walls proved too strong for the Dornish to overcome, but Dane burned fields, farms, and villages for 20 leagues around the city, and slew Lord Hightower's younger son, Garmin, when the boy led a sortie against him. Sir Adam Hightower reached Nightsong, only to find that Lord Fowler had put the castle to the torch and its garrison to the sword. Lord Caron and his wife and children had been carried back to Dorne as captives. Rather than pursue, Sir Adam returned at once to Old Town to relieve the city, but Sir Joffrey and his army had melted back into the mountains as well. Old Lord Manfred Hightower died soon after. Sir Adam succeeded his father as the Lord of the Hightower, as Old Town cried for its vengeance. King Aegon flew Balerion to Highgarden to take counsel with his Warden of the South, but Theo Tyrell, the young lord, was most reluctant to contemplate another invasion of Dorne after the fate that had befallen his father. Once again, the king unleashes dragons against Dorne. Aegon himself fell upon Skyreach, vowing to make the Fowler seat a second Harrenhal. Visenya and Vhagar brought fire and blood to Starfall, and Rhaenys and Meraxes returned once more to the Hellhold, where tragedy struck. The Targaryen dragons, bred and trained to battle, had flown through storms of spears and arrows on many occasions, and suffered little harm. The scales of a full-grown dragon were harder than steel, and even those arrows that struck seldom penetrated enough to do more than enrage the great beasts. But as Meraxes banked above the Hellholt, a defender atop the castle's highest tower triggered a scorpion, and a yard-long iron bolt caught the queen's dragon in the right eye. Meraxes did not die at once, but came crashing to the earth in mortal agony, destroying the tower and a large section of the Hellholt's curtain wall in her death throes. Whether Rhaenys Targaryen outlived her dragon remains a matter of dispute. Some say that she lost her seat and fell to her death, others that she was crushed beneath Meraxes in the castle yard. A few accounts claim the queen survived her dragon's fall, only to die a slow death by torment in the dungeons of the Ullers. The true circumstances of her demise will likely never be known, but Rhaenys Targaryen, sister and wife to King Aegon I, perished at the Hellholt in Dorne in the 10th year after the conquest. The next 2 years were the years of the Dragon's Wrath. Every castle in Dorne was burned thrice over, as Balerion and Vhagar returned time and time again. The sands around the Hellholt were fused into glass in places, so hot was Balerion's fiery breath. The Dornish lords were forced into hiding, but even that did not buy them safety. Lord Fowler, Lord Vaith, Lady Tolland, and four successive lords of the Hellholt were murdered one after another, for the Iron Throne had offered a lord's ransom in gold for the head of any Dornish lord. Only two of the killers lived to collect the rewards, however, and the Dornishmen took their reprisals, repaying blood with blood. Lord Connington of Griffin's Roost was killed whilst hunting. Lord Mertens of Mistwood poisoned with his whole household by a cask of Dornish wine, and Lord Fell smothered in a brothel in King's Landing. Nor were the Targaryens themselves exempt. The king was attacked thrice, and would have fallen on two of those occasions but for his guards. Queen Visenya was set upon one night in King's Landing. Two of her escorts were slain before Visenya herself cut down the last attacker with Dark Sister. The most infamous act of the Bloody Age occurred in 12 AC, when Will of Will, the widow lover, arrived uninvited at the wedding of Sir John Caffarin, heir to Fawntown, to Alice Oakheart, daughter of the Lord of Old Oak. Admitted through a postern gate by a treacherous servant, the Will attackers slew Lord Oakheart and most of the wedding guests, then made the bride look on as they gelded her husband. Afterward, they took turns raping Lady Alice and her handmaids, then carried them off and sold them to a Mirish slaver. By then, Dorne was a smoking desert, beset by famine, plague, and blight.
A blasted land, traders from the Free Cities called it.
Yet House Martell still remained unbowed, unbent, unbroken, as their words avowed. One Dornish knight, brought before Queen Visenya as a captive, insisted that Meriam Martell would sooner see her people dead than slaves to House Targaryen. Visenya replied that she and her brother would be glad to oblige the princess. Age and ill health finally did what dragons and armies could not. In 13 AC, Meriam Martell, the Yellow Toad of Dorne, died aged, whilst having intimate relations with a stallion, her enemies insisted.
Her son Nymor succeeded as Lord of Sunspear and Prince of Dorne. 60 years old, his health already failing, the new Dornish prince had no appetite for further slaughter. He began his reign by sending a delegation to King's Landing to return the skull of the dragon Meraxes and offer King Aegon terms of peace. His own heir, his daughter Daria, led the embassy. Prince Nymor's peace proposals encountered strong opposition in King's Landing. Queen Visenya was hard set against them. "No peace without submission," she declared, and her friends on the King's Council echoed her words. Orys Baratheon, who had grown bent and bitter in his later years, argued for sending Princess Daria back to her father, less a hand. Lord Okhart sent a raven, suggesting that the Dornish girl be sold into the meanest brothel in King's Landing till every beggar in the city has had his pleasure of her. Aegon Targaryen dismissed all such proposals. Princess Daria had come as an envoy under a banner of peace and would suffer no harm under his roof, he vowed. The king was weary of war, all men agreed, but granting the Dornishmen peace without submission would be tantamount to saying that his beloved sister Rhaenys had died in vain, that all the blood and death had been for naught. The lords of his small council further cautioned that any such peace could be seen as a sign of weakness and might encourage fresh rebellions, which would then need to be put down. Aegon knew that the Reach, the Stormlands, and the Marches had suffered grievously during the fighting, and neither would forgive nor forget. Even in King's Landing, the king dared not to let the Dornish outside the Aegon Fort without a strong escort for fear that the small folk of the city would tear them to pieces. For all these reasons, Grand Maester Lucan wrote later, the king was on the point of refusing the Dornish proposals and continuing the war. It was then that Princess Daria presented the king with a sealed letter from her father. "For your eyes only, your grace." King Aegon read Prince Nymor's words in open court, stone-faced and silent, while seated on the Iron Throne. When he rose forward, men said his hand was dripping blood. He burned the letter and never spoke of it again, but that night he mounted Beleriand and flew off across the waters of Blackwater Bay to Dragonstone upon its smoking mountain. When he returned the next morning, Aegon Targaryen agreed to the terms proposed by Nymor. Soon thereafter, he signed a treaty of eternal peace with Dorne. To this day, no one can say with certainty what might have been in Daria's letter. Some claim it was a simple plea from one father to another, heartfelt words that touch King Aegon's heart. Others insist it was a list of all those lords and noble knights who had lost their lives during the war. Certain septons went as far to suggest that the missive was ensorcelled, that it had been written by the Yellow Toad before her death, using a vial of Queen Rhaenys' own blood for ink, so that the king would be helpless to resist its malign magic. Grand Maester Clegg, who came to King's Landing many years later, concluded that Dorne no longer had the strength to fight. Driven by desperation, Clegg suggested, Prince Nymor might have threatened that, should his peace be refused, he would engage the faceless men of Braavos to kill King Aegon's son and heir, Queen Rhaenys' boy, Aenys, then but 6 years old. It may be so, but no man will ever truly know. Thus ended the First Dornish War, 4 AC to 13 AC. The Yellow Toad of Dorne had done what Harren the Black, the Two Kings, and Torrhen Stark could not. She had defeated Aegon Targaryen and his dragons. Yet north of the Red Mountains, her tactics earned only scorn. Dornish courage became a mocking name for cowardice amongst the lords and knights of Aegon's kingdoms. "The toad hops into a hole when threatened," wrote one scribe. Another said, "Meriah fought like a woman, with lies and treachery and witchery." The Dornish victory, if victory it was seen to be dishonorable, and the survivors of the fight, and the sons and brothers of those who had fallen, promised one another that another day would come, and with it, a reckoning. Their vengeance would need to wait for a future generation, and the accession of a younger, more bloodthirsty king. Though he would sit the Iron Throne for another 24 years, the Dornish conflict was Aegon the Conqueror's last war.